anybody in here dependent on Jesus? I mean, like, totally dependent on Jesus. And there's no point without him. It's a waste of time without him, right? Yeah. Feel free to sing with us. The song is simple. It says,
tell me, what can I do? 'Cause I can't live without you. I can't live without you. Oh, tell me, what can I do? 'Cause I can't live without you. I can't live without you. Oh, tell me, what can I do? 'Cause I can't live without you. Can't live without you. Oh, tell me, what can I do? 'Cause I can't live without you. No, I can't live without you. So here's my heart, and here's my mind. I give you my soul, Lord. Need you to take control. 'Cause I tried it all, tried it on my own, but what I found is I can't make it on my own.
Together in the house, clap those hands unto the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, I feel the presence of the Lord in the house. Why don't we take just a few minutes, give God some praise right now. I know it's Wednesday night, but I feel the Holy Ghost in this place tonight. And I'll tell you what, if you'll exercise that faith, if you'll exercise the faith that you've got. You say, Brother Winslow, I don't have a lot of faith. You know, God will use what you have. If you got enough faith to raise those hands and declare, my issue is going to be gone, God's going to see me through. Come on, God responds to faith. I heard someone say one time, if God responded to need, I'd be the first one in line that he'd meet. But God responds to faith. Amen? And where faith is, anything can happen. Somebody say hallelujah if you believe that. Amen, amen. Give God one more great hand clap of praise. Thank you, praise team. I tell you what, I feel the Holy Ghost in here tonight. Is it just me? Maybe I just ate something before I got here. I don't know. Anybody feel the Holy Ghost in here? My goodness. Praise God. Amen. Before we get into the word of the Lord tonight, amen, let me just do an infomercial for us for just a moment. And we would like to have all you strong men say hallelujah. Incriminated yourself there. Hallelujah. We need all you men, even those maybe that are not strong. Amen. We need you immediately after service if you would please meet over in our multi-purpose room. We need some help doing some things in there to set some things up for some events we're doing this week. So please, men, don't head out too quickly. You were proud to flex just a moment ago, so we want you to flex again right after service. And that way our ladies don't have to move these. So men, please just hang around, and directly after service, they will need your help. And then on Friday, those that would be willing to help out, do some setting up and some things like that, if you would see me directly after service, you're saying, what is it? Have you ever had somebody call you and say, do you have a truck? What is the answer? No. Right? Because you don't even know what it's about, but you know that there's work involved. When someone says, do you own a pickup truck? You know, And so so I'm going to do exactly what you don't want me to do. I'm just going to say, if you are willing to help out on Friday, you're saying what time? See me right after service, and we want to talk to you about helping us do some things on Friday. Amen. But directly after service, please, men, if you would help us do some things in our multi-purpose room to get it set up. Amen for legacy. All right, you got your Bibles with you? Amen. Let's turn to the Word of the Lord. Psalms chapter 119. Psalms 119, 105. When you're there, say amen. Psalm says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Amen. Would you put your Bible down? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Amen. Father, we give you praise in this house tonight. Lord, we're asking that this word would go forth, that God, it would do something in our spirit, that we would leave here different. God, that's why we come to church. We come to church so we can be transformed. We come to church so we can be challenged in our faith. We come to church so we can walk away with keys and tools and principles of your word that will change us and help us walk closer to you than we ever walked before. And I'm asking when we leave this place tonight that the word will do just that. And everybody say, in Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. I want to preach to us, teach to us a little bit tonight. And we're going to get off of our study for a while. We've been doing exploring God's word, and we're going to pause on that for a little while. And I've just been having, just in my devotion and my time of reading, just some things the Lord's been dealing with me. And I want to share this with you. And I want to preach to us tonight the power of love. The power of love. The world has many definitions for what love is and what love looks like. Ask anyone in the world and you're going to get a varied, broad definition. You can walk out into Walmart tonight and pick 10 people and ask those 10 people, what is love? And most likely you'll get some biblical answers sprinkled in with maybe some worldly views, and then you'll get some views that are way out there in left field. How many know I'm talking about what love is? And so this world has many ideas of what love is. And if we leave it up to the world, the definition of love becomes, well, it changes every 5 to 10 years, doesn't it? But our understanding and our definition comes from God and His Word. God and His Word. His Word is the standard, and it is the example of what love is. And so I just want to share from the Word of the Lord the power of love and what love does in our life. We read in Psalms 119 that the psalmist said that the Word of God should help us walk in our life, in our walk with God. He said, "The Word is a lamp unto my feet, and it is a light unto my path." In other words, the Word of God is that foundation that we walk upon. If you want to know what love is and the definition of love, and we're going to talk about this tonight, the definition, we find it in God's Word. And the reason we turn to God's Word is because His Word is a lamp unto my feet. In other words, when that light shines upon your feet, it lets you know where you are. That's what the psalmist means when he says, the word of God is a lamp unto my feet. It lets me know where I'm standing. If you want to know where you're standing, let God's word be a light unto your feet. And then the psalmist says, it's a light unto my path. We have two different things that are happening here. One is the feet represents where you are, and the path represents where you're heading. And God's word is the revelation. It's the definition of love. It's the understanding and the foundation of love. It's God's word is that key in our life that tells us where we are, but it also tells us where we're going. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful that God lets us know where we're heading. Come on, somebody. Amen. I want to know where I'm at. I want to know how to live for God today. I want to know what God's word says about how I walk with God today, because a lot of what we do today determines tomorrow. And so it's important that we allow the word of God to be a light under our feet. But I'm thankful that it just doesn't say where I am, but God reveals where we can head to. And I'm going to tell you something. If you're in a struggle, in a battle tonight, or you're dealing with things, the Word of God can illuminate your path and let you know that, hey, I got good things in store for you. I got promises coming your way. I got blessings coming your way. And I don't know about you, but that excites me to know that God's Word has something to say about my future. How many of you have, don't point at nobody. How many of you know people that always point out where you're at, what you do wrong, what's this and that? But how many of you are thankful for the ones that point to where God's going to take you? I thank God for people like that. Yes, reality is reality, but I'm thankful that God says, I've got something for you. So the psalmist says, the Word of God is a lamp unto my feet where I'm at and a light unto my path where I'm going. If you want to know where to go, let God's Word be a light unto you. Somebody say amen. 1 John chapter 4, verse 8 says, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Not that God has love, but that God is love. Now, I want us to understand this. John says, for God is love. Would you say God is love? God and His Word is where we get our understanding of love. And I'm not just talking about loving your wife and or your husband. I'm just talking about love in general. Now, it'll affect everything. We're going to talk about a lot of stuff. It'll affect every area of your life. But if we want to know what love is, if we want to know what it means to demonstrate love, then God's Word has to be where we open up and we say, what does God's Word say? The reason why God's Word is important to understand love is because it's the light of the path. And it's also because God is love. And if God is love, then we need to understand, what does His Word say about it? Let's look at John chapter 13, verse number 34. John chapter 13, verse number 34. A new commandment, would you say a new commandment? I give unto you that you love who? One another. As I have loved you, and ye also love one another, by this is so important now, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if you have love one to another. Now, this is amazing because there are a lot of things in God's Word that we could point at that would be an indicator or a marker of us being a disciple, right? There's lots of things. If you've been baptized in Jesus' name, that's a pretty good indicator you're a disciple. If you're filled with the Holy Ghost, that's a great example that you are a disciple. If you give to the church, I mean, no, that's a great example of being a disciple. There are lots of things that God's Word says that are indicators and markers of being a follower of Jesus Christ. And yet, of all the things that Jesus could say that would be the identifying marker of someone who is sold out to me, is that you love one another. He could have said, if you're a giver to the temple, and that would have been accurate. He could have said, if you shout and worship, that would have been accurate. He could have said, if you fill with the Holy Ghost, and he could have went down the list of biblical things, and every single one of them would have been accurate. But I believe there's a reason why that when Jesus is speaking in John, and he tells them, by this shall all men know that you are my disciple, that you have love for one another. The reason is because God knew and he understood that as time progressed and as we got closer to the end time, that the world would turn against itself. And the world, the media and all the politics and everything out there, it would turn on each other, and hatred would be the order of the day, and turning on each other would be the order of the day. And God knew that in the end time, the world would be looking for something that it could not find out there. And God said, I'll tell you what it's going to be. When people want to know, do you really follow Jesus? They're going to say, I want to see something that I cannot find out there. And you know what it is? He said that you have love one toward another. I'm going to tell sinner first. You know how they're going to know that we're different? It's how we love each other. You know how they're going to tell that we follow after Jesus? It's not just because you talk in tongues and you run the aisles and you shout and you give and you dress holy. Let me tell you, it's going to be because you love one another. Hallelujah. It's why we love one another, because this world is ate up with hatred. I mean, they're finding any reason to hate you, Republican, Democrat. I mean, money, no money, Ford, Chevy. Woo, got a little Holy Ghost on that one. I mean, people trying to say spiritual, hallelujah. People are just biting at the bit to try to find a reason to hate somebody, right? But the Lord said, I want you to understand that when you love one another, it's the greatest marker that you follow after me. It's the greatest thing you can do. The love that we share toward each other is a strong identifying marker that we're with Jesus and that he's with us. And it makes perfect sense, because that is what this world needs to see. You know, when you love somebody, this world, it blows their mind, doesn't it? When you just love somebody, you show the love of God to someone, it blows their mind, because they'll never find it out there, but they'll find it in God's house, and they'll find it amongst the people of God, because that is our identifier, is that we love one another. It stands out in a crowd that doesn't have love towards each other. 1 John chapter 4, 19 says this: we love him, watch this now, because he first loved us. Don't skip past that quickly now. I want you to see this. We love him, John said, because he first loved us. This means that God loved us when we didn't even love him. It means that his love towards us was there before you ever woke up one morning and thought, I love the Lord. His love was already on you. His love was already toward you before you ever thought in a moment, I love the Lord. And I know we got a bunch of people in here that love God, but let me just tell each of us, he loved us before you and I ever loved him. Before you ever lifted your hands and said, I love you, I magnify you, God loved us. You say, Brother Winslow, what's that got to do? Let me tell you what it is. Love doesn't wait until the other person loves you back. Oh, I'm going to say it again. Love doesn't wait until the other person loves you back. He loved us when we didn't love him. He loved us when we didn't even know who he was. He loved us when we were in sin. He loved us when we were in chaos. He loved us when we never once showed love to him. And what am I saying? And I'm telling you, we got to understand what love is. Love is a love that says, I'll love you even if you don't love me back. I'll love you first. Some of us are waiting for somebody else to love us before we love them. That's not how God works, and that's not how love is. Love simply says, whether you love me or not, I want you to know I love you. I love you. I love you. And that's a love that this world needs to understand. You may be chaotic out there and a mess out there, but we love you anyhow. Woo, somebody say hallelujah. Love doesn't say, when you love me, then I'll love you. Love says, even if you don't love me, I love you. See, that's not the love of the world, is it? Because the world is a type of love that is, what have you done for me lately? Right? It's I'll love you if there's something in it for me. But the love of God and the love of the Word of God and the love that God puts in us when we live for him is a love that says, no matter what you think and what you do, I love you. That kind of love will turn the world upside down. When we take that in our communities, our jobs, and wherever we may go in life, and we demonstrate a love that says, if I get nothing out of this, I love you. If I don't get a sale out of this, still love you. I mean, what would happen, honestly, if you told one of your customers, I love you, man? I don't know. They may not come back. I don't know. But what would happen if you just had that love that said, no matter what, I love you. I ain't got to wait for you to love me back. Listen, marriages, it don't matter if you're married, it don't matter if it's your kids, it don't matter what is your life. If you'll understand that true love is a love that says, no matter what I get in return, I'm going to give you love. It'll change everything in your life. It is the love that this world is in desperate need of. A love that says no matter what, no matter what political area you're in, no matter what financial status, no matter where you come from, I love you. Come on, somebody. That's what we need today, don't we? You turn on the news and my goodness, everybody's at each other. What would happen if the church, the true church, stood up and said, I don't care where you're from. I don't care who you voted for. Come on, somebody. I'm going to love you anyhow. I tell you what, things would begin to happen in our communities, wouldn't it? If we just got back to loving people. Matthew chapter 5, verse number 43 says, ye have heard that it hath been said. He's telling them, here's your information, but I'm about to flip it on its head. Because you have heard that it's been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor. Woo, that's good. Thy neighbor is that one you get along with, that person that you're connected with, you know. And he said, you have heard that, yay, love your neighbor, but hate your enemy. Watch what Jesus does. Jesus says, but I say unto you, love your enemies. Woo. Let's get back to that loving your neighbor thing, right? I don't know, maybe some of your neighbor is your enemy. Hallelujah. But God was saying, Jesus was saying, listen, I want to give you the definition of love. I want you to understand what love is. Love is not just loving those who have a good rapport with you. Love is not just something you give somebody because you're walking in the path together, you're voting in the same booth together, you're reading the same book together. Love is the one who's persecuting. Love is the enemy. Love is that one that you have nothing in common with. Love is that one that you look at and you got more reasons to walk away than you got reasons to stay. Loving your enemies is looking at that one that you could point out all the things that would be justifiable, yet you say, doesn't matter, I'm going to love you. I'm going to tell this church, the world needs to understand that the love that comes from God is a love that says no matter what, no matter who you are, no matter what it is, even my enemies, I'm going to love them. You say, Brother Winslow, that's easier to say than do, but I'm telling you, it's the secret to a blessed life is loving those around you. Maybe someone in your home, maybe someone in your family, a family member, you're just like every time you're around them, my God, hallelujah, love them. Matter of fact, one of the greatest things you can do is to show somebody that has a wall up, show them love. Love will do more in a moment's time than all your doctrinal teaching and all of your messages and sermons, and we need that. But love is what the world needs. Matthew said, love your neighbor, sure, but love your enemies. The Word says, love each other. The Word says, love even though they don't love you back. The Word says, love even your enemies. It's this kind of love that is not found in the world. Please hear me tonight. This kind of love is not found in the world. It's why it's so potent. That's why the love that we get when we follow God and we're filled with the Holy Ghost and we're following after Him, that love that's put in us, that is the love of God that we show forth. It's why it's so powerful. It's why it's so potent. Because the enemy knows that when you get in a place where you love the unlovable, you love the ones who maybe deserve something, right? You love those ones that can't give you back. You love those ones that haven't loved you back or whatever. The enemy knows. Are you hearing me tonight? The enemy knows that when you love, it begins to break down walls. It begins to tear down what the enemy tries to do. The greatest thing you can do in your marriage is just settle it. I'm going to love them. No amens. Hallelujah. Make it up in your mind. I know I said this wasn't going to be about marriages, but here it is. Make it up in your mind. I'm going to love him. I'm not saying he's your enemy. Hallelujah. But just make it up in your mind. I'm going to love them. This kind of love is not found in the world. It's why it's so potent. This kind of love, it confuses the devil. Confuses him. You want to confuse the enemy? Just get love so much in you, man, you just love everybody. Come on, somebody, just love everybody. It'll confuse the fire out of them. This kind of love can spark revival. Come on, somebody. This kind of love can spark revival. It can change your marriage. It can change your life. It can change your relationships. It can change your outlook. It can change every position you're in. This kind of love makes the world take notice. John chapter 3, verse 16, we all know this one. How many can quote this? John 3, 16. It's one of the first verses you learn, isn't it? John 3 and 16. I want us to see this because this is so powerful about love. For God so loved the world. Would you say so loved? That he gave his only begotten son. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I want you to get this. For God so loved. Would you say loved? He loved that he gave. Now we can read the rest of that, but let's stop right there. For God so loved the world that he gave. That he gave. Love is a giver. Love gives. It doesn't take. Love gives. What was the reason why he would take his only begotten son and allow him to go through the pains of the cross? The Bible says it was one reason, love. Why would he endure the cross? Why would he allow the punishment and the pain and the cruelty that would be placed upon him for our sins? Love. The Bible says that Jesus could have called 10,000 angels and they would have descended from heaven and they would have taken him off the cross if he would have just said, I'm not doing this. Angels would have removed him from the cross. But what was it that made him endure the cross? Love. What was it that made him say, I'm going to take my only son, not one of three, but one, and said, I'm going to allow that one begotten son to die on a cross? Love. Love is a giver. Love gives. It doesn't take. It has a heart and a spirit that says, I want to give. The spirit of this world says, what's in it for me? But love doesn't say that. Love doesn't enter the picture with, what am I getting out of this? Love says, what can I give out of this? Love doesn't walk into a circumstance and say, before I say anything, what's in it for me? Love says, it doesn't matter if I get anything out of this. It doesn't matter if I get anything in return. I'm going to just simply give. Why? Because love is a giver. Hallelujah. You say, Brother Winslow, that's easy to say and hard to do. You're absolutely right, it is. It's hard to give with nothing in return. It's hard to give when you get nothing back. It's hard to go into situations, circumstances, and nothing's coming back but you're loving forth. But let me just remind you, before you give up on loving somebody because you're not getting nothing in return, let me just remind you that your God, your Lord, your Savior, he showed forth love. He gave with nothing being given in return. Because love gives. Somebody say love gives. The spirit of this world says, tell me what I'm getting and then I'll tell you what I'm giving. But God says that's not how it works. That love simply is like God. He simply said, I'm about to do something that's uncomfortable. But I want you to know I'm going to do it because I love you. Because the love I have compels me. When we get the love of God flow in our life, it will cause you to be a giver. It'll cause you, and listen, I know some of you are like, oh, if it's taking an offering. We're not talking about giving money. We're not talking about that. Real love has a heart to give, but we're not talking about offerings. We're not talking about that. I'm talking about in your normal routine of life, when you encounter other people and situations, that you have a heart that says, I want to give. A heart that says, I want to contribute. A heart that says, I want to pour out, not pull in. That's what a heart is, to give. And that is what we get from God. It is the only reason that God gave his only son, because of love. And I know sometimes we can hear conversations about love and it can become so comical, like, "Woo, our church is a church of love." You know, we kind of hear stuff thrown around like that. It almost becomes kind of, you know, but the truth is it's true, isn't it? That love is at the foundation of everything that we do. You know why you're here tonight? You're not here for Brother Winslow. You know why you're here? Because you love God. Let's just singleize that love. The reason why you're here faithfully on a Wednesday night is because something in you says, "I love him." Love. It's why you'll get in a car and some of you drive, you know, 25, 30 minutes, even longer than that. And why do you do that? Because of love. Love compels. How many of you remember when you were dating? Ooh, come on, somebody. Ooh, you drive through hailstorms. Come on now. Some of y'all looking at each other like, yeah. Some of y'all looking at each other like, you haven't done that in a while. Listen up, pastor's talking to you. Ooh. Come on, how many know what I'm talking about? When me and Sister Winslow were dating, she lived in West Monroe. I lived in Minden. And so I'd drive to see her, she'd drive to see me. And never once when I was driving did I think, "Oh my Lord, I gotta drive to see her." Not one time. You know what? I couldn't wait. Woo, I couldn't wait till Friday or, you know, whatever. I get in the car and I have my music. Woo. Love. That's all y'all gonna get. Hallelujah. And I was excited to see her. And it didn't matter how far I had to drive. And I think she felt the same way. And she's driving to see me. And I didn't think, my goodness, this is ridiculous. You know, why? You know why? Love. Love calls me to do things. Love, I mean, some of y'all, when y'all dating, and that good thing will look at you and say, I want this and I want that. You didn't say, "Well, how much is that going to cost?" You like, "Baby, whatever you want, charge it." Y'all know it's true. Come on now. Hallelujah. You'd do anything for her, wouldn't you? And I pray you still do everything for her, because love shouldn't have left. Hallelujah. It should have continually got, man, I think I'm getting in hot water. Ooh, hallelujah. Love compels us to do things. You're here tonight because you love God. You come Sunday morning, Sunday night. Why? Because you love God. You tell people about this church and God. Why? Because you love God. You love this truth. Why? It compels you because of love. Love is the key. And I'm not just talking about offerings. I'm talking about every day of your life and your routine and the day-to-day things. That love of God, when it shines forth, it blows people's minds. When you just have a heart to give to people. I want us to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And as you're turning there, most of us will recognize this as the wedding chapter. Anybody recognize it as the wedding chapter? This is a passage of scripture that is read many times at weddings because it talks about love. And that is fitting because you ought to get married because you love them. Amen. So it's very fitting. But while this is quoted many times at weddings, it's good for weddings, it's not just for weddings. This is a passage of scripture that applies to every area of your life. It's powerful. I want us to look at this. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse number 1 says, "Though I speak with the tongues of men and the tongues of angels," rather, "and of angels, and have not charity." In the King James, it's charity. In other translations, New Living Translations, it's love. Charity means love. So when we read charity, I want you just to picture the word love. I want you to see what 1 Corinthians says. Lots here to unpack. "Though I speak with tongues of men," I want you to see this. He is talking about speaking in tongues. Then he says, "of angels." You can speak in tongues that people can interpret. You can speak in tongues that somebody may understand. You may speak in Chinese and somebody may be fluent in Chinese and hear you speaking. Or you may speak in a language of angels. Nobody understands it. Only heaven knows that tongue. And so he says, even if I speak in that. Now, how many of you know how powerful the Holy Ghost is in tongues? Powerful, isn't it? How many know this church believes in tongues? Powerful. I want you just to just hold that in the back of your thought as we're reading this. He said, though I speak in tongues, watch this, and have not love, I am become as a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. Now, as powerful as tongues is, and Paul said it, he said, I pray in tongues more than any of you. Jude said it like this. He said, praying in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. So we know that praying in tongues is powerful and it's needed in the church. Somebody say amen. We don't need less tongues. We need more tongues. But he said, if you do that, if you pray in tongues, if you speak in the tongues of men or the tongues of angels, but you don't have love, then what is it that you got? Are you seeing how powerful love is? That here is the New Testament plan of salvation that declares you're going to receive the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. But here he says, even if you do that, but you don't love, it's nothing without love. He said it's like you become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal, just making noise. That's what he said. He said if you get up and pray in tongues, and y'all know I pray in tongues, and so we ain't talking against it. But let me just say, you can get up and hallelujah and go to town, but you can walk out those doors and not have love. And God says to him, it's a bunch of noise. That's how powerful love is. He's not diminishing tongues. He's just uplifting love. He's not saying tongues is not important. He's saying, but love is the key. That's why I say everything we do, love's got to be the foundation. Somebody say amen. Verse number 2. And though I have the gift of prophecy. How many of you thank God for the gift of prophecy? I thank God for it. I'm telling you, I thank God for it. Experienced it a couple weeks ago. I thank God for prophecy. I thank God that when he speaks to his church, prophecy. But look what he says. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries, meaning there's nothing hidden from me, I get everything. Understand it. Watch what he says, though. And all knowledge, and though I have all faith, how many know faith is important? Faith is important. So that I could remove mountains. He said, if you can get up and you got faith. You know what he's referencing? He's referencing when Jesus said, if you'll speak to the mountain and command it to be plucked up and cast into the sea, it will do. He's referencing, if you got the faith to move a mountain, you can walk in this place or walk into your house and you got faith oozing out of every pore. And people are like, my God, that's a woman of faith. My God, that's a man of faith. Right? But he said, if you can move mountains and you got faith and you've got the gift of prophecy and you understand all mysteries and all knowledge so that you can remove mountains and you have not love, he said, I am nothing. Powerful, isn't it? Powerful. Because love is the foundation of everything you and I do in our lives. Let's look at verse number 3. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not love, it profiteth me nothing. Verse 4. Charity, love, suffereth long. In other words, it's patient. This is the part that we talk about in weddings. Love is patient. Woo. But listen to this. This is for all of us. Love suffereth long. And is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth not itself and is not puffed up. In other words, seeking its own will, its own pleasure. What's in it for me? Verse 5, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeking not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil. In other words, doesn't dishonor others. It isn't self-seeking or easily angered. Keeps no record of wrongdoing. Look at verse number 6. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things. Have I lost you yet? Because that's a lot, isn't it? But God said, that's what love is. Now, do we hit it on the head every day? Absolutely not. Is there anybody in here that can say, I do that every day? No, we don't. But it's something that God is saying to us, that as we walk this life with God, whether it's 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years before God comes back, and we're walking this life with God, he's saying, I want you to understand that love beareth all things. That love believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. That love never faileth. But whether there be prophecies, now watch this, whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. Now, I'm not going to preach on this, but let me just help us. That doesn't mean that when the apostles came and went away, that tongues are no longer valid. There are some who use that verse to say, see, tongues cease. No, this is talking, it explains in the next verse. Verse number 9, for we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when that which is perfect is come, there's the key. What it's saying is that not that tongues has ceased, and not that prophecy has ceased, and not that faith has ceased. What it's saying is that it will cease when that which is made perfect. How many of you know what that's talking about? Heaven. None of us will ever be perfect until we get over there. So you can go ahead and let your husband off the hook. None of us are going to be perfect. None of us are going to, we're always going to make some kind of stub our toe and do something. But the Bible says that there's going to come a day that we're going to be perfected. We're going to make it. That's what it says when it says, but that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away with. That is talking about when we get to heaven, those things will not be in play anymore. But until then, tongues and prophecy are still there. But look at what he says, verse 11. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know even as also I am known. Verse 13, here's where it is. And now abideth faith, hope, charity or love. Faith, hope, love. These three, now before I finish it, let me just say this. There are three powerful things that God says out of all the things you experience. He says faith, hope, and love. If you've got faith, you can get through anything. Anything. If you got hope, you can get through anything. And if you've got love, you can get through anything. Now watch what he says at the closing of verse 13. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, or love. These three, but the greatest of these is what? Love, charity. Isn't that powerful? See, we hunger for faith, and we should. We desire more faith. How many want more faith? I want more faith. We should. How many are thankful for hope? Because without hope, ooh, it'd be miserable, wouldn't it? I thank God for hope. But he said, faith is great, hope is great, but he said the greatest of these three is love. Why love? Why not faith? Why not hope? Why love? Why is love so potent and powerful? Let me tell you this. Faith, hope, love. Faith is powerful, hope is powerful, but he said the greatest of these is love. Love is the greatest because of its power to affect things around us. Watch this now. It's powerful because it will continue forever. I want you to think about this. Love has no ending. It will continue for eternity. When we get to heaven, faith won't be needed. But you need it here. Hope won't be needed in heaven, but love will still be there. That's why God said, listen, if you get anything, get this. Love's the key, because it is the only thing that when you get to heaven, you won't need faith that God will get you through and faith in God. You're going to be with him. You won't need hope for something to happen. You'll be living it every day for eternity. But love is still going to be there. Why is love still going to be in heaven? We started with the verse, didn't we? God is love. It's because God will be with us for eternity, and God is love. Therefore, love will continue on. The greatest thing you can pray for, yes, pray. I pray for miracles, signs, and wonders. I absolutely do. I pray that God heals everybody I pray for. I am not just doing it ritually. I am seeking that God through faith will do something. But let me tell you, the greatest thing you can pray for is love. Love. Let's stand. There's somebody in this place tonight. You might be going through a trial or a struggle. And you might be feeling alone, but you're not alone. Hear me tonight. You're not alone. God's love for you is more than you could ever imagine. His love towards you is deeper than you can ever fathom. His love towards us is grander than anything on the outside. God's love for you and I is beyond. We will never fully comprehend the love that God has for us, but Romans gives us a pretty good glimpse. Romans chapter 8, verse 35. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Not what, who? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Will those things separate us from the love of God? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. Through him that what? Loved us. You know why you can be a conqueror with whatever you're dealing with? And not just a conqueror, but more than a conqueror? Because he loves you. When you're standing there in your prayer time and you don't feel mighty flows of faith and you're just, what am I doing? What's this happening? What's going on? God, I don't feel this. I don't feel that. You just stop yourself and you say, I'm more than a conqueror because of his love for me. You say, Brother Winslow, you sure God loves me? Yes. He said, what or who shall separate us from the love of God? Verse 38, for I am persuaded. This is so good. Get this in your spirit tonight. For I am persuaded. That means my mind's made up. You can't change it. Somebody needs to get persuaded in this church tonight that God is for you. Somebody needs to hear your pastor tonight, and you need to let the devil know, I'm persuaded. I'm leaving this church service tonight persuaded. My mind's made up that God is for me, and God is with me, and God loves me. And it doesn't matter if the finances are off, or this is off, or relationships. It doesn't matter. God's with me, and God's for me, because God loves me. If you can ever get that in your mind, God loves you. It doesn't matter what the enemy throws at you. You can make it through. He said, for I am persuaded that neither death, would you say death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I asked my dad one time, I said, Dad, how does the gifts flow? And how does miracles work? And how does all these things? And he, at the time when he told me, I thought it was, I wanted something deeper. You know, I wanted like a 10-step plan, fast every Tuesday, Thursday, you know, pray from 7 to 12, you know, something like that. I remember him telling me, he said, son, the key the supernatural is love. And I remember when he told me years ago when he told me, I thought, oh, that's so corny. Give me something, you know, apostolic that I can preach with. He said, love. He said, when you have love for someone, your faith will be there. When you lay hands on somebody and that love in you wants them to be healed because you feel what they're going. Love. He said it's every time that Jesus operated, every time Jesus healed, every time Jesus opened a blind eye, every time that he healed a lame, he said it was love that was operating. It was love. When he told Zacchaeus, come down, Zacchaeus, a man that was hated, a man that was talked about and because of the taxes and all of the stuff that he had, yet Jesus said, come down, today I'm going to your house. What would make Jesus put himself in a position for those to cast stones at him? Love. He said, love. And in Romans, it gives us every way that we can think of how the love of God can never be separated. Amen. Amen. I want you, if you would close your eyes. And at the conclusion of this service here, if you want prayer, we want to pray with you. But I just want to remind all of us that in your despair, in your life and the things you're going through in your daily routines, not only are we to show forth love, but I want you to know that God loves you. That God loves you with a love that we fully can understand, but we can understand it enough to know that God, no matter what I'm going through and no matter what I'm dealing with and no matter what's going on in my life, God, you love me. And I want to encourage us today before we leave this place. And if you need prayer, we're going to pray with you. We'll anoint you. If you need a miracle, you need a healing, God can do it tonight. If you need a breakthrough, God can do it tonight. But I want you to know that when you leave this place, God loves you. God knows where you are. God sees you. And somebody needs to hear these words. He has not forgotten you. Hallelujah. I feel that in the Holy Ghost. Somebody needs to hear that God has not forgotten you and he sees you. Father, we pray in your wonderful name, Jesus. God, I ask as we leave this house tonight, I'm asking that those that are here, that God, they need to hear these words that you love them. I'm praying that God, you would wrap your arms around them like never before and they would feel the love of God like never before. Lord, as they are in those places of being alone, those places where the enemy's attacking, the places where maybe their health is not, that they've got a bad report or things in relationships and they're wondering, God, where are you? And God, how are we going to manage this, God? I want them to be encouraged that, God, you love them. And there is nothing we could ever go through and nothing we could ever deal with that, God, your love will ever be separated. Your love for us is intense. Your love for us is great. Your love for us is grand. And I want them to be encouraged. Encourage when they leave this place tonight that you love them in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Would you give God a great hand clap of praise in this house? Come on, would you praise him just for a moment? Come on, just tell him, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. You can be dismissed. If you'll shake somebody's hand on your way out, let them know you love them. If you would like prayer, we would love to pray with you. Anoint a cloth if you want it. Amen. God bless you. Amen. We will see you Sunday. Men, don't forget.